And as you've heard from Donna and some of the other speakers, this is the 15th, well, actually, April was the 15th anniversary of the release of the Vriend decision. And I'm quite happy to say that one of our affiliated agencies was one of the 17 interveners in the case, by the time the case arose to the level of the Supreme Court of Canada. And as it turns out, Sheila Greckle was actually on our board. So that's kind of exciting. Anyway, I know, I get excited by strange things. But interestingly, the law that was being challenged at the time was called the Individuals' Rights Protection Act, or IRPA for short. Then that changed again a few years later to the Alberta Human Rights, Citizenship and Multiculturalism Act, or as I like to say to my students, for short, HICMA, which to me sounds like a hairball in a cat's mouth. But anyway, it's now called the Alberta Human Rights Act. And you've heard about what happened with Delwin's case. He started off at the Court of Queen's Bench trying to get, and was successful, getting a declaration from the court, Justice Russell, saying that sexual orientation should be read in to the Human Rights Act, because it was to the then IRPA, because it was obviously not a protected ground. But unfortunately, on appeal to the Alberta Court of Appeal, in a 2-1 decision, they allowed the government's appeal, with Justice Connie Hunt dissenting. And in that case, first of all, one of the judges, McClung, Justice McClung, held that sexual orientation, the government's, did amount to a government action under Section 32. And then both of the judges held that Section 15 of the Charter was not violated, and therefore any problem we have with sexual orientation in our law has to do with our social affairs rather than the operation of the Act. And you hear that from time to time from judges. But Justice Hunt disagreed, and she agreed with the lower court that the failure of the government to provide such protection was a violation of Section 15 and could not be saved by Section 1. Then all 9 judges in the Supreme Court heard the matter, although Justice Sapinka died in November 1997, so he wasn't able to participate in the judgment. Our Alberta judge, Justice Major, was the only sole dissent in the judgment, but the majority held again that the charter was under, the charter could be subjected to under-inclusive legislation such as the IRPA, and the omission of sexual orientation created a distinction between gays and lesbians and other disadvantaged groups which were protected. And it had a disproportionate effect, this omission, on gays and lesbian. And so therefore, this omission could not be justified again under Charter Section 1. And the remedy, which was fairly unique at the time, was to order that certain sections of the Act include the word sexual orientation. So that was unique, but that took 8 years, Delwin, as you, I'm sure you realize. And that, and whether it was because of that or for other reasons, even though he was successful in that case, he didn't go back to try to make a complaint to the Human Rights Commission. Since that case was decided, we've seen some really interesting developments. Obviously, as mentioned, finally, in 2009, effective 2010, many years after the Vriend case was decided, we finally added those words to our legislation. And so a newcomer, we even had this happen at our office, newcomers in Alberta in the interim period after the case and before the Act was amended would ask, so I guess there's no protection in Alberta for sexual orientation. So you'd have to know about the Vriend case to be able to be aware that that was protected under our legislation until much later. In addition, since then, we've added the dreaded Section 11.1, and Dan is going to talk to you about that. Suffice it to say that I have written, and my center has written extensively about this section, and not in a positive way, I'm afraid. Other legal developments, we've now recognized after 1999 in the M&H case that it was discriminatory to exclude same-sex couples from benefits programs. We've also had several provinces since then introduce legislation recognizing same-sex relationships. In 2002, the Immigrant and Refugee Protection Act, which is also IRPA for short, recognize same-sex partners as common law spouses who can enter Canada if they establish there's a conjugal relationship. Our criminal code was amended in 2004 to include sexual orientation as a ground for the protection from hate crimes in sections 318 and 319. We also had a case that was quite famous in 2002 where a young man, Mark Hall, was successful in being permitted to attend his prom at a Catholic school with his same-sex partner. Canada also, in 2005, became the fourth country in the world to enact legislation permitting same-sex marriage in a reference. It was started with a reference case, and later we got civil legislation that permits it. We've also had cases involving same-sex survivors, and in 2007, an interesting case out of the Ontario Court of Appeal allowed that in some cases, children who are in same-sex families, relationships, can have more than two legally recognized parents. That case is called AA and BB. And then the rest of the people are called CC and DD, actually, but anyway. More recent developments include the recognition of adoption in some jurisdictions by same-sex couples. In Alberta, it's called step-parent adoption, but don't get me started. recognition that gays and lesbians are openly allowed to serve in the military, and also transgender and transsexual people can serve. It doesn't say openly, but they can serve. We've seen some IVF access for lesbians, and as of 2013, males who have sex with other males, as long as they've been celibate for 5 years, are allowed to donate blood. Now that's not great, but it's an improvement over the previous section. And finally, we actually today, thanks to Jennifer, found out that we've known for a while that there's a university that's seeking to be accredited as a law school. And in the law, the university, it's called Trinity Western University, and you've probably heard of it because there have been other cases involving teachers. Now they want to have a law school. And all potential students have to sign a covenant agreement, which forms part of their process in applying, and it applies to their behavior at all times, not just on campus. You must abstain from sexual intimacy that violates the sacredness of marriage between a man and a woman. If you cannot live up to this covenant, you have the right to be disciplined or dismissed or refused readmission. And so the part that's of great concern to all of us who are interested in this issue, shut up, Linda, okay, is that the meeting to decide whether or not they will be accredited is being held in secret. And so nobody can ascertain, and this will be tomorrow, actually. So watch the news. There are some protests going on as a result. So consequently, I just want to make a quick list of some of the current issues that have yet to be decided. Homophobia and transphobia in schools is a big problem. Gay seniors have problems, especially when they face extended care issues. And we also have a lot of laws that are still lagging behind with regard to gender identity and not recognizing transgender and transsexual people who need protection from discrimination and violence. Thank you for your patience.